Del Rio, Texas. Home of Lake Amistad. Your host, Rob Wade. This guy who dives. This episode of This Guy Who Dives recorded live Sunday, 16 April 2017. Episode 169. Happy Easter 2017. Well, welcome once again, everybody, to another exciting episode of This Guy Who Dives, and I am your host, Rob Wade. And no, I haven't turned Scottish on you. And looks like we're going to be competing with a storm going on out here. Our phones are blowing up. My various notifications are blowing up here, telling us that we have a severe thunderstorm going on. As a matter of fact, what was the latest news? Of course, we get it twice because my wife and I both work at Laughlin Air Force Base. And so we get notifications from work as well as from just the weather apps that we have going. So, yeah. Weather warning, lightning within five. Of course, if I were on the base, I'd be shutting all the computers down. But because I want to get this episode out, I am sticking with you guys. And looks like I have somebody. Oh, cool. Just some people reacting to the fact that we're on Facebook Live. So hopefully the storm will not get in the way of the show, but we'll see what happens. I'm trying to type here. Wow, my keyboard just stopped working on my Surface Pro. Oh goodness. So yeah, I'm joining the app, whatever. So yeah, this is interesting. Sorry, I'm working through some technical challenges. Now, interestingly, the issues that we've been among the issues that we've been dealing with has been the ability to get our traffic out. You know, we pay for the top of the Spectrum. Time Warner sold their internet business to Spectrum, so. The service that Spectrum provides actually is much better than what we were getting with Time Warner. So we're paying for, you know, a ridiculous amount of download speed, but also really, really healthy upload speed. We're like pushing 20 megabits per second, and which is great when you're broadcasting. A lot of folks don't understand they just I want to have fast internet. Well, really there's two aspects to that. There's the download speeds. What? It's interesting. We see more, you see, your upload speeds and download speeds are different. Now, most people are consuming over the internet, so they are, they're more concerned with their download speed. But for people like me who are into podcasting, netcasting, if you are a gamer who likes to live stream your games, then you want a pretty decent upload speed. Depending on the resolution, again, it's like downloading video, we're uploading video. Where this is live stream, and it actually is in 720p, which is the basic HD. My cameras and my system are actually capable of doing full 1080p HD. I'm not ready for 4K yet. in order to get that out, you have to have a pretty decent speed. And obviously, because the software that we use, XSplit, also records the show as we're broadcasting. So it's simultaneously doing that. So that allows me at the end of the broadcast to actually turn around and upload it straight to YouTube. Obviously the size of the file at 1080p would be much larger than it is already at 720p. So I'm kind of taking the the best of both worlds kind of thing, giving you HD, but also keeping the consumption. Your download speeds don't have to be nearly as strenuous. And if you're like us, you have multiple people in the house. Well, of course, for us, multiple is two. But you have multiple people. If you have a decent sized family, then what you have is probably downloading something, and so your spouse may be watching Netflix or some other video heavy download, and then your kids may be playing some video games. So you want to have a really good download speed, and so I'm giving you HD without really killing your download speeds tremendously. So, and I'm just watching our big screen over here connected to the server to make sure that the signal I think is going out is actually getting out to you guys. So so it looks like it is so far, and I'm watching the storm, listening for the storm. We've had some pretty good thunderclaps so far. So let me go back to my home page here so I can see if there's any traffic. You know, one of the things I really hate about Facebook is I always want to have most recent, and yet invariably after I've changed it to most recent, Facebook arbitrarily changes it back to top newsfeed. I don't care about what they think the top stories are. It's that simple. I want the latest news and information. So so anyway, let me get to my OneNote. So yes, today is Easter. I hope you had a really nice church service this morning, or if you did yours yesterday evening, for those who might have Saturday night services. I hope you had a great service, that it spoke to you, and because my wife and I are very involved in church and involved in, you know, praise and worship music, that kind of thing. So it's a significant time for us to share with a lot of our friends and adoptive family, I guess, if you will. And it's an important time that we remember what this is about. This isn't about a bunny and some eggs, although, you know, the kiddos like that, and that's fine. But it's about Jesus, who died and was resurrected for us. And so it's important that folks remember that and realize that there's more to our faith than just a couple of events a year, Easter and Christmas. There's a whole relationship involved there. So hopefully you had a great service and some great fellowship with folks. And who knows, you may have some people at your church who made that conversion, gave their lives to Christ for the first time, and have never really had that opportunity before, and maybe this was their first opportunity to do it. So it was a great service that we had at our church, and well, we have a great time anyway, but it was just a really great service, a lot of great music. Let's see, movie reviews. We don't have any because there really hasn't been anything on lately. As a matter of fact, looking back at my movie list, let me explode it here. I think last episode we reviewed Ghost in the Shell. Really don't look to have much in April, where it really looks like the next thing coming up is going to be Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 in May. So looking forward to that. But having said that, I do have a couple of reviews that I do want to share with you. And a few episodes ago, we kind of started adding in let me turn down the audio over here. We did start including reviews of like Netflix, Hulu series, those kinds of things, because that is really becoming a greater trend here, is seeing shows that are only available, they're only made available via those paid services and its original content. So there's a couple of shows that I'd like to share with you with some caution. The first one is from Netflix. Actually, both of these are from Netflix. The first one is 13 Reasons Why. Now, I will warn you off right off the bat. It is real. I mean, by real, well, there goes the thunder. You might be able to hear it over the microphones. By real, I mean it's a honest look at high school life following. It's so uniquely told and presented. It's the story, and I won't give, well, there's really not much to the way of spoilers, because it, and at the beginning of the show is basically the end of the show. It is a cautionary tale about cyberbullying, rape, all and ultimately teen suicide, and it's all involving high school kids. It follows a particular person who, in the beginning of this 13 episode series, why I called 13 Reasons Why, we know that she committed suicide, and what she's done is she has created 13 cassette tapes speaking to particular people who all were connected to what ultimately resulted in her decision to kill herself. And it centers on her, we're following mostly the guy who friended her, but who is kind of socially inept, trying to fit in, but doesn't really know how to properly process, and he's kind of oblivious to certain things. And these audio tapes that he's listening to, he's not the first person to listen to. The girl who committed suicide, she left specific instructions to another friend to give these to a person, and each person was supposed to give it to the next person on the list. Otherwise, it would be very, very publicly released. And so the world basically, you know, and of course, we live in a very socially connected, socially networked world. And so this stuff goes like, you know, anything, you know, if it shows up on YouTube, obviously it would be huge. So using that as leverage, she has each of these people who had a part to play in her ultimate decision to commit suicide, has to listen to these. And so you have an interesting move of this kid listening to the audio tapes, and then we see the flashbacks of what actually is happening as he's, you know, as he's been listening to it. So it's kind of like he starts listening to it, and then it segues into you actually see what happened. And in some cases, what's interesting, because there's a map that he has to follow to go to different locations where some of these critical points that affected her happened, so he could see it. You have some instances where he's going to the place and it's like he is there virtually as it's happening. So he sees like her leaving a store or leaving a house or something like that, or going to it. It's brilliantly put together, and you really, really get invested in her as a character. You feel it's hard to describe. You find yourself really, really wanting to get to the end of it to find out, well, where does it go? Because obviously it doesn't go well because she committed suicide, and you know that right off the bat. But it's amazing. It's amazing seeing the brutal honesty of what kids are going through. And I've been aware that this kind of stuff goes on. And a lot of parents, I just think, turn a deaf ear and a blind eye to it. They think, oh, not my kid. Matter of fact, you see some of that played out where it involves her, where it involves the guy that's a friend whom we're following in this. You see that whole thing played out with the parents. No, certainly not our kid, that he couldn't or she couldn't. But the fact is, these things are going on and they're real. So the language is, it's brutal. There are a couple of the episodes that where it gets the reenactment of the rape. They have the specific cautionary, you know, about the content at the first of it. So you're prepared. I'll be honest with you. I have recommended this series to a lot of folks, especially with kids in high school. I leave it up to you parents to decide whether or not you want to have them watch it. If you do, I strongly suggest that you watch it with them because it's 13 episodes. Each episode is worthy of having discussions that should automatically be generated as you watch it. In fact, you as a parent might want to watch it first, make some notes of points that you want to discuss rather than have it totally free, freestyle. But that's your call. But I really, really do think that it's important, you know, for junior high and high school. I think for parents of kids of that age, this is a profound series to watch. It really had a profound effect on me. I think counselors, because a counselor figures heavily, especially towards the end of this. You see the politics of school boards and school decisions. You see a number of things that are really, truly, honestly in play. This is about as real as it gets for modern high schools. So I give this an absolute 10, but with the caution that it is brutally honest and realistic. So Netflix original series, Selena Gomez actually had, she's one of the executive producers. I tell you, I was really, really shocked that this level of sophistication and brutal honesty was produced this way. It was brilliantly done. It sets you up gradually for what's coming because you largely don't find out anything any sooner than the main guy in this series. So you're learning it as he's learning it. So I give it a 10. Now, the other Netflix series that I've only just started, and I got to say, I'm cautiously optimistic and happy to see it out, is Mystery Science Theater 3000, The Return. Now, I'd read that it was coming back, and Joel Hodgson, who was originally part of the original series of MST3K, is producing and doing a lot of the writing, etc. And so it's got kind of a new cast, although familiar characters are in the show. If you're not familiar with Mystery Science Theater 3000 or MST3K, it is a show that is very, very, very low production values, but it's intentionally so, where a guy and some robots are stuck in space and they're forced through this evil experimentation to watch really, really bad science fiction and horror movies. And what you do is you see them in silhouette sitting in like what looks like a theater, and they're watching the movie and they're making comments. They're cracking on on the movie. And so often it's just brilliantly done, but sometimes the humor can be a little bit over your head of over the head of folks, depending on what your background is. I watched the first episode of the Return, and it was as funny as the original was. You'll probably, if you're a geek, if you're a nerd, you'll probably recognize some of the actors that are in here. As a matter of fact, the guy who plays I think it's Agent Johnson, who has he's triplets or clones, we're not exactly sure. He's in, has a recurring role in Marvel's Agents of Shield. He's the right hand henchman in this show. So anyway, the first episode was good. I was happy. I was pleased with it. So right now I'll give it an 8 because I want some room to grow because it could be that the first episode was the best. But we shall see. So if you're an MST3K fan, jump out there and start checking that out because I'm starting to watch it. Okay, so tech updates. We've been dealing with lots of hardware issues, and it turns out not all of it was software updates or operating system updates. Our wireless router was finally biting the dust. We had an old Cisco router, and finally I was like, okay, we're tasking it a lot. We've got so much streaming media that we're punching through this thing that I needed something that was going to be much more robust. So did a lot of research. I wasn't ready to spend $600 on a router, but we spent $300 on a router, and we got the Netgear Nighthawk X6, and it is a behemoth. I mean, it takes up a good chunk of the rolling counter where the server is. So, but it's doing a good job. I mean, the throughput even over Wi-Fi is ridiculous. Ran the NetSpeed app, and it was just crazy. My wife's already and her Surface Pro 4 in her scrapbooking room is in the opposite corner of the house, and she was getting tremendous throughput with that. Ugh, more junk mail. So my expectation is that's going to solve our issues there. It would just stop working every so often. I mean, it would be working as far as you could tell, but your connection would be non-existent. It just show your connection but no internet. You couldn't download or upload anything, and it was actually getting worse first on upload speeds, which of course if I'm doing the show is a problem. So all right, on the Windows front, a new update came out for both PC, tablets, laptops, as well as the phones, but with a really nasty announcement. Microsoft is no longer, they've basically shrunk the number of the Windows phone devices that they're going to support. So if you have older devices like a 1520 and some of the others, a 1020, you may have been part of the insider program up to this point, but they're... Oh, here's Ronan wanting to be back up. Let's switch cameras real quick. So, come here. Say hi to everybody. So, sit down. So now, unless you have one of the newer phones, one of the phones on their list, they are not going to allow you to get past load any newer updates. They're no longer officially supported. So if you were an insider program and you were getting all the latest releases prior to being fully published to everybody, that program is pretty much done for you. So, which is really disappointing. That kind of makes people feel that that's going to be the end of Windows Phone. And it may really be, because what Microsoft is starting to signal hard now is that they're really moving to full Windows on everything. So they've started to come out with, not for us, but internally, they've started to come out with full Windows 10 on ARM chips, which is the type of chips that most of your smartphones use, your iPhones, Androids, and everything else. So what that means is for... here comes the rain, or hopefully not hail. So what that means is you would literally have a full capable PC in your pocket. So we'll see where that goes. Last weekend, we had a very successful event. I'm in a contemporary Christian band called Living Water Sound, headed by Rich Morneau, who is also the praise and worship leader at the church we're now going to. We had an outreach event in the front of Walmart last weekend, working with a couple of rap artists. One, Harmony, whom we have worked with before. He has a great testimony. And then somebody we hadn't worked with before, again, one name only, Bianca. She has an awesome testimony as well. Speaking of suicide, she had gone down that dark path and had attempted suicide. And God basically rescued her from that, gave her a path to go on. And so she has a beautiful voice as well as being able to rap. Now, I'm not a huge fan of rap at all, but these two people just nailed it. The message was right. The style was right. They were articulate. Well done. So we had a great time. As a matter of fact, I have a picture up. One of the folks from our church took this photo, so it's not the greatest shot, but there you have us. It kind of looks like, what's this background? This is literally the wall, the front wall of Walmart there. It's because it's such a big store. So they have this patio area where normally you would see a lot of shopping carts and stuff, so they cleared those out of the way for us to set everything up. So, and it was a long weekend because it was both a Friday night and the Saturday night. It was long, long. Setting up at like 4:30 and then finishing up 11:30 at night. But it was worthwhile. Touched a lot of folks and entertained as well. You know, you can be entertained by Christian music and Christian rap, and plenty of folks were. So we had a great time. So there's me on the keys and vocals, and then the pastor of our church, Tommy Sondag, on lead guitar and backup vocals, and then in the back there is Danny Salas, who's our newest drummer, and then Rich Morneau there on the acoustic guitar, lead vocals, and leader of the band, and also the writer of a lot of the music. We do some covers. And then all the way over there on bass is George McKnight. And so it's been a wild ride. We had a great time, and it was a fantastic opportunity. So if you happen to have been in the local area and got to see the show or got to see the outreach, then hopefully you got something out of it and shared it. Some of my friends did come out to check it out, and they enjoyed it as well. So, all right, the next segment. lake levels are, what in the world is going on here? Lake levels are beginning to drop. They're letting some more water out. What? This is weird. Huh. That's interesting. I had a new update that I do have a premium license, and so it's not letting me do a preview edit. I'm gonna have to contact them about that, find out what's going on. So anyway, lake levels are beginning to drop, and it's not looking good for the home team, except for the possibility that they might maybe open up the old spur 454, which is where I love diving out there. I love diving out there because it's easy access, but there is a cliff area that as you swim around from the cove, It's just a sheer drop. It's not nearly as deep a drop as, say, Castle Canyon, but it is pretty awesome. But I took some pictures of how much the lake is dropping out at, this is Governor's Landing. Let's see if I can get this thing to move forward. Hello. There we go. Oh, man, why did it go sideways? It didn't look that way earlier. Oh, all of these are sideways. Really? Oh, okay. I have to apologize. This, I don't know why it's doing this, but it didn't do this before. But you can see how shallow this is. Now, if you look at where the dark part of the pylon is for this Highway 90 bridge going over Lake Amistad, you see the darker area goes up, you see a kind of a really, really dark line straight across, or straight up in this case. That is the most frequent level, the most normal level of the water. So you see how shallow it is now. I mean, and this is, you see how shallow it's like just a few inches deep right here at the shore. And it's not that much deeper even as you walk out to that first pylon. Just a couple of years ago, I would dive I'd be diving here. I'd be well underwater here. But sadly that's the lake's dropping. But it's in this weird in-between state right now. It's not low enough for them yet to open up 454, but they keep saying they're going to be letting more water out. So if that happens, that means I have a good chance of getting to go back out to 454. I love diving out at 454 again because it's so easy to access, much more easy to access than Scuba Cove, which you've seen. Oh, there's more thunder. Which you've seen before in pictures and video. That's a steep old walk, and that's where I went diving yesterday, as a matter of fact. And I want to share a little bit of that. Well, I want to share that video with you guys so you can see what it's like right now. So let me pull up the video. Where's my video? That was weird. All right, this is the famous dive chest. I normally do not see this many bass out. So you can see visibility is not really improved. We've just had so much of this weather, intermittent rain. I mean, just this past week was a mess. This is a welcome sight, I gotta say. Now, it's my understanding years ago, when we used to have dive shops here, there was a platform that was actually up off of the... It was resting on the bottom, but it was kind of mounted up on stilts, if you will, or framework. And it was kind of like this as well for training. So this is just hanging at 15 feet, which is a little bit shallower than I would really like. I really can't do a controlled emergency swimming ascent skill exercise that shallow. But for a number of other things like the mass clearing, regulator clearing and recovery, those kinds of things, this is a perfect setup for. In this video, as usual, hello Mr. Bass, or probably Miss Bass, using the Sea Life DC 1400 Pro camera, and I've got it set to not using, even though I have the lights on it, I've got it because the neat thing about the DC 1400 is that it has built-in digital filtering. So before you start your dive, you can go into the setup mode. It's very easy. You can tell it, okay, are you using it on the surface or using underwater? If you're using underwater, then you say, all right, are you using the flash? Are you using the video light? Are you using both? Or are you using neither? If you're using neither, then you then get the option to select whether you're basically at snorkeling depth or if you're actually diving. And so, obviously, at a shallower depth that you typically snorkel, you don't need as much filtering because not that much of your red frequency is filtered out by the water. The deeper you go, you lose those reds, which is why it looks green or blue as you go deeper. So, I set it to be operating without the lights and as a dive, so it's got a pretty heavy red filter on here. You see a lot of the algae that has already started to grow closer to the surface. This is like you should have noticed there when I pulled up my my console, we were at 15 feet at that point. But you know, the thing is with, for me with diving is, even as chilly as it was on this dive, I say chilly, it was cold. As cold as it was still a dive. It was 30 minutes of bliss. I love diving that much. Even when the visibility is this bad, when the temperature's cold, it's still 33 minutes underwater. It's just so relaxing. And I know a lot of people who just, they only dive once every couple of years if they're going on a trip somewhere, you know, to the Caribbean or whatever, and they just refuse to check out non-tropical diving. I mean, there are times when I'll go dive there at San Felipe Creek, which is 10 feet at its deepest, but it's a constant 76 degrees year round, so it's fairly comfortable. If you're in a 5 mil full, you're really comfortable, but you can do it in a 3 mil shorty. Visibility is not bad unless you have a bunch of kids playing in the water. So again, visibility was pretty much an average of 10 feet. Once I got down to about 60 feet, I hit a spot where the visibility dropped to really to zero. It just, there was a layer of something. Some particulate, like a cloud almost, at that level. If I dropped below that, it started to open up again, but at that point it was cold and I just needed to get a little bit closer to the surface because 5 mil full just wasn't doing it for me. So 65 degrees. So we need a lot more hot, I mean hot weather. People have complained already, oh, it's getting so warm here. And I'm like, come on, folks. This isn't even close to how hot it can get here. And for me as a diver, if I want to have a comfortable time out here, because I much prefer diving in a 3 mil shorty, we need a lot more hot weather. I mean, we're talking, it's got to spend days pushing 100 to start to warm this lake up for any depth. See, already can see the temperatures dropping. 67 as I'm working my way down. But you see, this punctuates my point that I make all the time. Buy your own gear. There's, as inexpensive as gear is now, there's just no reason not to, as a diver, not to own your own gear. Because, and I've said this many times as well, the statistics bear it out. If you own your own gear, you're much more likely to actually dive. Okay? So, if all you're lacking then is tanks and weights, then you can rent those just about anywhere. Or, most places you can find some place that does air fills. And I'll be honest with you, if you don't mind spending about $3,000, you can get an inexpensive, and probably less if you buy one used. You can get a single user kind of compressor. The one that I have was $7,000, and It can fill two tanks. It supports continuous run, and it can fill two tanks in about 20 minutes. This was a good size carp that came by. I mean, this was as large as some of the groupers I've seen. Tell you, more and more of this small sunken boat is showing up to be exposed as the lake levels have changed so much. I could show you before and after pictures or video how much of this was buried under silt and rock before. But when the lake actually dropped low enough that this was actually exposed. This was above the water. And here I think I'm at 31 feet. I think I pull up, as I cruise over it, I think I pull up my console. And you see the depth. I want to say it was set 31. Reacting as the thunder gets louder. You see a hair, one of those hair barrettes or whatever they call it, hair band. The skill of finding things underwater is looking for things that are looking for shapes that don't occur naturally. Now there have been occasions that there have been exceptions to that where nature did create something that was just a very human looked like it was created by people. But generally speaking, if you go slow and take it easy, you'll pick things up. You'll notice things that just aren't, even covered in silt, are not a natural shape. So they draw your attention. And there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. My dive yesterday out at Lake Amistad, Scuba Cove, right here by Del Rio, Texas. I need to try and adjust this. All right, so another thing I discovered, or that I was reminded of, and I would remind my diving friends out there, we have talked about before a nice upgrade to your regulator called the mouthpiece by Ceti. The beautiful thing about Ceti is, let me see if I can find their website. I should have preloaded that website. Ceti. Mouthpiece. Where are you? Oh, come on. No, I don't want it to news. Dun, dun, dun. Here we go. Switch to screen region. Oh, come on. It's not picking it up.
So if that's not working, let's try it. That's interesting. Finding yet some other issues. This should be piece of cake. Oh, come on. Add. Whoa. Something drastically bad has happened here. Something's locked up the computer. See if I get Task Manager to release me. Oh, there we go. Now it's working, sort of. That was weird. Okay, so I'm definitely finding an issue there with their latest update. See, this is the challenge of when you're working with new stuff. Bring this back up. There we go. Back to normal. So, all right. So this is cool because it comes in different colors. I still want purple. I don't need the pink. I would be okay with the blue. I've got the original white one. But the beauty of these things is that they're made that same material that mouth guards are made out of for sports. So you heat up some water, you dip this in for whatever amount of time it is, so it's pliable. And then before it cools down too much, you bite into it so it conforms to your dental work. And then you can trim it off where you need to, because this part of the mouthpiece can extend way out here. And so if you have a very sensitive gag reflex, you may want to trim this back. But what this does is it makes it easier for you to hold on to the mouthpiece. You get jaw fatigue much less. Much less jaw fatigue because you lightly bite down to it because it's conformed to your teeth. Unlike your generic mouthpieces. I had some dental work done, and what I forgot to do, because it's been a couple of months since I did it, and it's been longer than that since I got to do a dive, I did not take the mouthpiece off and reshape it to fit my dental work. So it felt funny when I put this in my mouth today or yesterday. So if you have the Ceti mouthpieces and you get dental work done, I highly recommend that you take the time to go ahead and redo the shaping of it so it fits your teeth, and you will continue to enjoy a comfortable dive. All right, so one of the things I wanted to talk about before we close out here is driving and diving. Now, this is not the same kind of thing or an admonishment of like drinking and driving, in which you shouldn't drink and dive either. But one of the things that, because my wife and I had to buy a car this year, we used our tax return money, which we normally set aside to do our dive trips. So that means this year, no dive trip for us. But, well, we want to take advantage of some quasi-local diving. So one of the things we want to do is drive down to the Texas Gulf Coast and dive on... Wow, there's something really weird going on with the computer here. And dive the Texas Clipper and the abandoned oil rigs. And so it would be basically more local diving. But we also go up to Balmoray State Park and dive. We normally try to do that two or three times during the summer as well. And so I wanted to share with you some thoughts, considerations, ideas, options to think about if you were doing more of the load up in a vehicle and drive to someplace that you're gonna dive. So I got some practical considerations here. Let me bring up my text. So first thing you want to consider is use a plastic tub instead of gear bags. Now, when you're traveling, flying, those kinds of things, gear bags are great. Make it easier to carry your stuff around. And typically,
you're not going to be able to dive the final day before you fly. So you're going to have better than 24 hours to let your stuff dry out. Let your stuff dry out when you're waiting, when you're doing your last minute sightseeing and shopping and things like that. But when you're driving somewhere, you're typically driving there. You may not be waiting all that long after you finish diving and driving, and you'll be driving home. So you're not going to want to mess up your vehicle or make it smell by having wet gear in there, which you throw it in a gear bag, it's going to be dripping all over the place. So consider using plastic tubs to load your gear into. You can close it up. It's easy to just throw stuff in there. And then when you get it home, then you can take it all out, air it, clean it, and hang it up to dry normal the way you normally would. So plastic tubs, a good way to keep your gear together. And you know, if you're like me, you mark everything, you label everything. So, you know, take your black magic marker or whatever and mark it what your gear breakdown is or whatever, you know, his and hers tubs or whatever. Next thing you want to do is find out where you can get air fills. Now, and this really is a good idea anywhere you're going to go. The further away you are going to go from where you normally dive, the more likely it is you're not going to have an idea where you might get air fills. Now, for me, it's kind of an easy proposition because we normally tow our mobile dive center with us. So I have my compressor and plenty of tanks. So I'm never, ooh, big thunder. I'm never lacking for air fills. Unless something were to happen to my compressor, you know, something stopped working or whatever. Where is that? It's a good idea to contact local dive shops or dive clubs or somebody in authority, knowledgeable where you're going to be diving to see if there are places to get air fills. Because that may mean that you, if there are no air fills available, you may want to make sure you bring plenty of tanks with you so you don't have to worry about air fills. Now, for instance, if you go to Balmoray State Park up close to Fort Stockton, one of the challenges there is actually a dive shop. I mean, even though it's a lot of instructors do their classes at Balmoray State Park because it's basically like a big natural pool. But there is actually a dive shop there. But I'll tell you, they charge an arm and a leg for everything. But you can get your air fills there. But you know, unless you called ahead, you may not know that. Coming to Del Rio, a lot of people like to dive Lake Amistad, especially from out of town. But it's tough to get air fills here. We did have a cascade. There was a company here, a shop here, that had a big cascade system. And it's still there, but the company was sold to somebody else. And I don't think they really have an interest or even the knowledge of how to use the cascade system to fill tanks. So while that would be the optimal place to go, I'm pretty much the only game in town when it comes to air fills. I'll be honest with you, I try not to advertise that too much because it's not designed to be that heavy duty. So if a big club wanted to come in, I don't think I could support that much work. Plus it would just take forever to do. I bought it to really support my training, my classes, as well as some recreational stuff. So, but you know, as long as I can keep it under control, if you contact me ahead, I'll fill your tanks for you at a very, very reasonable price. Also, speaking of contacting your local dive shops and clubs, contact them for just advice on local diving opportunities. If you were to call. You know, I do get contacted through the dive club
frequently by folks coming in from out of town, either moving here or visiting, asking about what the dive opportunities are here. And of course, I tell them a lot about Lake Amistad, but I also tell them about diving San Felipe Creek and also checking out the Frio River, Chalk Bluff, and then also, you know, the opportunity of driving. It's a 4-hour drive, but driving up to Balmoray State Park, which I think is just as I love the drive and I love the location. But contact the area ahead to find out, and not just for diving opportunities, but if there's a specific place that everybody goes to and you've never been there, you may want to talk to them about, okay, so what do I need to bring? Is it easy for entry? Does you know, for instance, if I tell people about Scuba Cove here, I tell them, okay, it's a protected area because they have buoys that are supposed to ward off, you know, boats. You're not supposed to bring powered boats in there. It's just for swimming and diving. But it is a steep walk down. So if you are not able to carry heavy loads, or you can't handle a very steep and long walk up, it may not be an area, it may not be a spot that you want to go diving. You may want to find an area that's not protected, so you'd have to put out a flag, but that you are that's much easier to access on the shore. And speaking of that, you may want to brush up on shore entries, particularly if you're going to an area that's like coastal where you have tides to deal with. It's a different kind of experience when if you are used to diving from boats, entries, exits are pretty much dictated by the boat captain or the dive master, and so there's not a lot of, it's a no frills kind of a thing. But when you are kind of diving on your own, you're driving to a location, you're diving from shore, it's a different way to deal with that because there are different challenges. So you need to consider brushing up, especially once you get there. You may want to find an area that's kind of out of the way of other people that might be there. Just kind of get familiar with what your challenges might be entering and exit the water. And be aware that things can change. Now, I will tell you from experience that we had, I was teaching a class here at Scuba Cove, and I was teaching a family, 3 generations, as a matter of fact, and it was a great class. We went in on the 4th dive, which at that time, there was no task loading on dive 4. It was just the recreational dive to just kind of work you through everything. when we popped up at the end of the dive, a isolated storm had literally built up overhead, and the wind, speaking of storm, there goes the thunder again. And the winds blowing into the cove were so massive that we were getting like ocean type waves crashing on the shore. And so I quickly had to, you know, make sure everybody was completely buoyant on the surface, and then talk them through a high surf exit on rocks and how to get out. And one of the people in this was an elderly gentleman. He was like pushing, you know, like 66 years old. And so I had to talk them through the process and then demonstrate how to do that. And so one at a time, I worked each one of them in. But this was not something they were prepared for, but it was a good class. I was able to demonstrate it. And this was their opportunity to experience it firsthand. So if they ever went somewhere where they were doing a lot of shore diving, that where there was high surf, they would now be familiar with that process. But if only diving you've ever done has been on a boat, then this may be something that you've never experienced before. So, or it's been a while since you've experienced. So you want to make sure that you get familiarized with that process. Brush up on your shore entries. And speaking of that, consider extra exposure protection. Now, when you go diving on boats, they have a pretty much cut and dried process. You know, you're going to be in for a certain amount of time. As a matter of fact, most of these places don't even actually watch the clock anymore because they know they're going to take you no deeper than a certain depth, and they tell you right off the bat, hey, I don't want you to go any deeper than I go, so that he has the actual, or she has the max depth of everybody. And you're going to come up no later than when he's ready to bring everybody up. And then you get out of the water, and you're going to be out of the water on the boat till you go to the second location, and then you're going to suit up or gear up and drop down, do your dive, and come back up. Very prescribed, programmatic. They know pretty much within 30 minutes how the whole morning or afternoon's going to go. And usually, you're going to places that are tropical and places where they typically, for the protection of the sea life there, they don't let you wear gloves, that kind of thing. Totally different picture when you are doing a shore dive out there. Now, that's where you have to consider the challenge you may have with a shore dive. If you're diving out here Lake Amistad, I can almost guarantee you, if you're not wearing booties for entry and exit, at least you're making a big mistake, because they're going to chew your feet up. If you're one of those that has likes the full-footed fin where it's fitted for you, it's at your size, and that you typically don't wear boots, then you're obviously, when you exit the water, you're going to be taking your flippers off, you're going to take your fins off, and you're going to be exiting the water. Or you're going to be entering the water with your fins in hand, and then you're going to ease out, slip into the water, you're going to slip your fins in, on, and then go do your dive. You're going to be in a lot of hurt trying to climb up and down rocks when you're carrying heavy gear. Won't be so bad if you're in sand, but you're going to want some sort of protection in just about every other condition. Similarly, gloves. Again, diving out here at Lake Amistad, I don't dive with gloves because I watch where I put my hands. But if you are not familiar with the area, you may want to bring gloves and wear those, because you've got places that people fish here. It's a big bass fishing lake. So you're going to have a lot of opportunity to get yourself stuck or grab a hold of a monofilament line that you can't see because it's virtually invisible underwater, and cut your hand on that or poke your hand with hooks. So you're going to want to consider diving with gloves. Similarly, if you happen to have to exit water in a high surf and it's very sharp, and you've got sharp rocks, you're going to be crawling out. So you don't want your hands to be pressing down on sharp rocks and paying the price for that. So that's something you may want to consider. What is going on here? And then also, typically, because you're diving for a very fixed, predictable amount of time in the water, and you're out of the water for a predictable amount of time, you don't necessarily need to have a lot of extra wetsuit protection, thickness, or going from a shorty to a full. When you're shore diving, you may actually be doing a lot more diving, spending a lot more time actually underwater. Because you're not at the beck and call, you're not having to come up out of the water because of other newer divers who happen to be less efficient on their air. Typically, when my wife and I are on these dive trips, we're with a wide variety of... Ooh, there went the lights. We're with a wide variety of people who have a wide variety of experience. And inevitably, we're coming up with everybody else with still plenty of air in our tanks. So when we're diving on our own, we're doing shore diving, we can dive as long as we are watching our nitrogen build up on our computers and we have air. So we can usually get a lot more dive time out of our tank. So if you're going to be spending a lot more time in the water, you are going to lose more heat during the course of your dive if you're spending a lot more time underwater. So you may want to, instead of diving with a 3 mil shorty, you may want to dive with a 3 mil full or a 5 mil. So those are things to consider to help protect you and make the dive much more comfortable. Last but not least, adhere to the Boy Scout motto: be prepared. Bring with you, especially if there's not actually a dive shop local, you need to bring all the things that you would normally be able to avail yourself of: a boat captain or an actual LDS, a local dive shop there. Okay, you'll want to bring with you a save dive kit, which typically is going to have various O-rings, one for your tank, one for your regulators, various size O-rings. It's going to have at least one mask, strap, replacement mask strap, a replacement fin strap, because those, I tell you, I have replaced at least four people's fin straps over the years because they break. A tool kit for assembling, disassembling certain pieces, for repairing pieces. Spare batteries. If you're diving with a computer, you'll want to bring a spare battery plus whatever mechanism your device is necessary to actually open up your computer, the back of your computer. There's a special tool that comes. We use Oceanic, and there's a special tool that's used for ours. Anything that you can think of that could possibly go wrong or break that you would want to spare for, you need to make sure you bring those things with you. First aid kit. Again, if you don't have some sort of support mechanism facility there, you may need to have a first aid kit. Even bring an O2 kit. Since I teach classes, I have all that. I have a first aid kit and I have an O2 kit. So I always bring that down with me when I'm teaching classes. So it's available if something goes wrong. Have an emergency plan. Have a rescue plan. Now, this is normally something that we teach in the rescue diver class. And as an instructor, I always have to have that at the ready. As a matter of fact, I have to show that to the park service here when I renew my permit to teach out here. They have to see that I do have an actual rescue plan. So then this is where contacting your local dive shop or dive clubs or other authorities in the area you're going to is important. They can tell you that information. They can tell you, okay, so if you're going to be diving here, here's your closest access to a recompression chamber. Is there a hospital nearby that has a recompression chamber in case somebody gets decompression sickness? How do you contact first responders? Can you simply get to 911? Is there cell service where you're going to be? I know at Lake Amistad, that's kind of a challenge. At Balmoray State Park, it's kind of a challenge to get a decent signal. So you need to make sure you have the things necessary, a way to quickly evac in case of emergency or deal with other kinds of emergencies right then and there. Is there somebody versed in CPR? Those kinds of things. So again, be prepared because these are things that you normally would be able to rely on the folks running a dive operation from a boat to do. They have all of that. They're trained for all of that. So you have to be your own rescuer, you and your group there. So those are some things to consider if you're going to be driving to a dive location. And I will, again, because this is out of Del Rio, I caution you to pay close attention to that diving here at Lake Amistad as well as Balmoray State Park. Balmoray State Park is kind of removed from everywhere. It's close to a very, very sleepy little town, but you'd have to go to probably Fort Stockton to actually get to a real hospital. Del Rio, believe it or not, we have this Valverde Regional Medical Center does not have a recompression chamber, but there's one in Uvalde, 70 miles away, and there's one in Eagle Pass, 50 miles away. Why we don't have one here where we have this massive lake, it just boggles my mind. But as a matter of fact, I have a friend that goes to the church we used to go to that she's on the board at the hospital there. I may have to ask her about that. So anyway, those are some things to consider if you're going to be driving to a location and doing some shore diving there. All right. Okay, let me bring up some administrivia real quick before we shut things down. All right, next dive club meeting at Rudy's, 20 April. Be there at 7 o'clock. Normally, I don't really see anybody showing up most of the time, but it's great food there. I like it. Well, some people are very picky about their barbecue, but I like Rudy's. It's just a nice open area, just kind of relax. I normally bring the tablet and everything, so if there's some videos that we can show or look up some things on the internet and just talk about diving, talk about local stuff. It's a great opportunity to connect. Dive classes for this year, the next one coming up, May 25th through the 28th, June 22nd through the 25th, July 27th through the 30th, August 24th through the 27th, September 28th through October 1st. And if you want to sign up for these classes, you need to sign up no later than the first week of that month. You can sign up much earlier. You could sign up now for the October class if you want. But in order for me to get your student materials to you in time for you to get some self-study done, get and complete the workbook, I need to have you sign up no later than the first week of the month of the class. And as always, we try to encourage people to get involved with the local pet rescue here, A Pet's Wish. You can look them up on the internet or visit their Facebook page, even better. Look up A Pet's Wish. It's a local pet rescue. They're always needing funds for food and medical supplies and emergency procedures. They do... Katrina is, God bless her. We spent a little over 2 years volunteering there, and it just got too much for us. We do still foster. We have one of our dogs is a foster from there, and a number of people in this town do foster. But because so many more in this town just abuse, neglect, or otherwise mistreat their animals, leave them stray, there's so much work to be done, so much help. And if you're in the market for a dog or a cat, first make sure that you're really prepared to have it. Have proper, secure facility, fences, etc. Because you're not allowed to keep your animals chained up outside. That's Texas law. And consider adopting from one of the from either a Pet's Wish or a local pet rescue near you. But please, I encourage you to look them up, donate money, donate some time. They could really use all of that. And then also, again, if you want to keep up with the ongoings in the dive community here, you can visit our website, DelRioDiveClub.com, or for more on-the-spot, last-minute kinds of information, more agile informational flow, visit our Facebook page. Just look for Del Rio Dive Club. And, of course, if you want to connect with the show, just look us up on Skype. Send us a message to TGWD. And, of course, if you want to connect with me directly, you can send me an email to robert.wade@setifox.net. Or you can follow me on the Twitter. Just look for at RobertCFP. That's all we have for this week. So hopefully you enjoyed the show, got a lot out of it, learned some new things about... the lake here if you've not been diving here, and hopefully we will see you next week if the storm doesn't take us out. We'll see you next week on another episode of This Guy Who Dives. See ya.